Well, welcome, everyone. Why don't you find a seat? There are many seats here at the front, so we'll get started. Thank you for coming out on such a lovely evening. My name is Tal Howard, and I am, sad to say, the outgoing director of the JAF program that's been going for 12 years. It's hard to believe this idea of a debate originated as just a little line in a grant proposal years ago, and it's been very gratifying to see that it's become a tradition here at Gordon. And I have just a few preliminary things to say before we get down to business. As I said, I'm the outgoing director of the JAF program. The two future directors are here, and I would ask them maybe just to briefly stand up, Jennifer Hevelone Harper and Paul Brink, and just be acknowledged. And we also have a number of alumni from the program, and also students are going to be in the JAF cohort, the 13th cohort, next academic year. I wonder if they would just briefly stand up and we would acknowledge you. And one alumna I should recognize, Amy Gentile. Where is she? Where is she? She, since graduating over a decade ago now, right, she's been to practically every debate except one, and she lives in New Hampshire, so that's just wonderful that she should get a debate all around. The topic tonight is about power, and this is a famous aphorism many of you have probably heard from a 19th century thinker, Lord Acton, and it goes, "Power tends to corrupt, and absolute power corrupts absolutely." And I think this is a very important topic. We live in structures of power. Many of you have and will occupy positions of power, and you have and will live under structures of power. So getting this right, thinking about it well and wisely, is no unimportant matter. So I'm very glad the students have agreed to do this. They've been coerced a little bit. They have to do this. But I want to say, too, that they've been given this topic. They're not necessarily experts on it. This is not a class in power or authority. And they were given the topic at the end of the fall semester. They were divided into two groups, and they've had to do all the research and work on this. I and the other directors this spring have virtually done nothing. So they have done a tremendous amount of work. And they're also not arguing for positions they actually hold. Maybe they do, maybe they don't. Maybe they've changed their opinion in the course of preparing for the debate. So this is really an exercise in oratory of learning to put the best face on a position. Let me go over the format and then say a little bit about your role, because the audience has a very important role tonight. And you have, or maybe your neighbor has, one of these handouts. And it is a structure. There'll be an opening statement by the pro team and then a rebuttal from the con team, and this will go in sequences. And Victoria Quay here will keep time so they do not go over time. So once your time is up, you have to exit stage, left or right. There will be a little time for questions from the audience. You can see after this second sequence of statements and rebuttals. And I would just ask you there'll be some mics that will be around. That you would ask a succinct question, not a long comment, and direct it to one team or the other. And I will moderate that Q&A time, and then there'll be a little time for you to ask one another questions if you think something has not been addressed or you want to weigh in on something something else. So at the end of the debate, we'll ask them all to exit through this exit, the door over here, and you will vote on who made the most compelling case. And this is very important here. Not asking you to vote on what you think about the resolution. So kind of try to step out of yourself and listen really who made the most compelling argument for their side. So that's a little bit of a challenge for you. So, and you know, if they bribed you, they shouldn't bribe you. It's your roommate, someone on your sports team. You can't vote for them on affinity basis, but really listen, because they put a lot of effort into this, and they expect you to put effort into listening and voting who you think made the best case for their particular position. I would ask you, too, to really listen and not be technologically disengaged from the event. So I would ask you to silence and put away cell phones. and stay off social media, but really have your full engaged presence. And if someone pulls theirs out, those around you shame them. Look at them like, my God, what are you doing? This is... And then after the debate, you're welcome to do Twitter as much as you want to, but for the debate, I'd ask you to put that away and have your complete undivided attention to really honor the work that these people have done. Let me introduce them now, and I would ask you to, I'll introduce one team at a time. Hold your applause until the end, and then you can, for the whole team. But let's see, the affirmative case, which is, where, over here, here we go. Kevin Neal, Ben Bowden, Kevin Kozlowski, Marissa Kovo, India Bolin, and Nathan Gray, and India Bolin has served as the captain for this group. So let's give them a hand. Okay, the negative case, Jeff McKay, Naomi Shear, Hope Komentakos, Jordan Van Altus, Sam Solberg, and Josh Rowling. And Sam Solberg has served as the captain for this team, so let's give them a big hand. During the debate, you might think of this as more golf than basketball as a sport. So if you would, they'll be coming up giving statements. If you would just hold your applause till the very end, and then we'll give them a huge hand as they go out and once we announce the winner at the end. So let me read the resolution one more time, and I will turn things over to them. Power tends to corrupt, and absolute power corrupts absolutely. Pro or con? And we'll begin with the opening statement of the pro team.
Imagine yourself looking over the wide expanse of Middle Earth, mountains as far as the eye can see, the Shire's rolling hills and Rivendell's tall pines to either side. Power over the entirety of Middle Earth, just within grasp, sitting in the pocket of little Frodo Baggins, the one ring to rule them all. This ring is sought by all, for through it Sauron expanded his power in an attempt to encompass all of Middle Earth. Those who acquire this ring and the absolute power that goes with it always fall to corruption. Sauron, the evil force of this world, uses its power to infiltrate the minds of his inferiors to do his bidding. He ordered the massacre of multiple races, using nine kings of men as his minions, whose corruption under the power of the ring has left them in suspension between life and death. The mere presence of it is enough to corrupt someone. Even our beloved Frodo falls prey to the power of the One Ring, abandoning his companions to seek glory for himself. The corruption of powerful individuals is an age-old theme. Such literary examples as Sauron from The Lord of the Rings, Voldemort from the Harry Potter series, and Napoleon from the novel Animal Farm cut close to our hearts. We see the corruption that ensues when these once harmless characters come into power, wreaking havoc on the lives of our beloved protagonists. Unfortunately, the corruption of power isn't contained merely within the literary world. It reflects real-world trends that are present in many different disciplines, like politics, economics, psychology, sociology, business, theology, and many more. Power tends to corrupt, and absolute power corrupts absolutely. These wise words written in the letter from Lord Acton expressed a tacit trend. Power, in some capacity, has seeped into every society over the course of human history. Power, the capacity to influence, manipulate, or control a group or a person's possessions, means, beliefs or ideas, and actions, can be achieved at multiple levels. For example, a parent has power over their child, and a king has power over the ruler of the people of his land. Both possess power, just to a different degree. A king has a greater degree of power with an influence over a greater number of people and a greater responsibility than is held by a parent. As found by numerous psychologists, like Galinsky, Winter, or DeSellis, those who possess power are less likely to express empathy towards others. The acquisition of power poisons the mind, turning one's actions, particularly towards inferiors, down the path of corruption. Corruption, the abuse of power with the intent of personal gain, has been exemplified through the actions of many well-known historical figures like Hitler, Stalin, Mussolini, Saul, David, Solomon. The list goes on and on. Many rulers that grow out of rebellions end up being just as corrupt as those they overthrew, like the current president of Zimbabwe, Robert Mugabe. Since coming into power, Mugabe has ordered the deaths of many of his rivals, ethnically cleansing Zimbabwe through the murder of 20,000 individuals. Seeing as power goes hand in hand with corruption, it logically follows that those who possess more power have a greater capacity for corruption. A parent can be corrupted by the power they possess, and a king can be even more corrupted by his greater degree of power. For all you statistically minded people, that means that a positive correlation exists between power and corruption. The more power possessed by an individual, the more corrupt they will become. Lord Acton's statement talks of the reality of absolute power. In Acton's original letter, he was addressing the lack of criticism expressed towards religious leaders and kings who were abusing their power. This power he speaks of is one within the human spectrum. True absolute power can only ever be achieved by God. Absolutes are theoretical entities unreachable by humans. Due to our flawed nature, we are incapable of being absolutely loving, absolutely forgiving, absolutely anything. There's no perfect theoretical absolute for humanity, and so we are forced to approach this within the realm of human capability. To be absolutely powerful as a human is to have reached the highest level of power capable of, to reach the highest level of power achievable by a person or persons. As we have shown that power and corruption move together on a sliding scale, it goes to say that those who possess absolute power are absolutely corrupt. This positive correlation shows that when power is absolute, so is the corruption. Kim Jong-un, the current supreme leader of North Korea, can be said to possess human absolute power. Once assuming power, Kim replaced all other high-ranking men within the government with his devoted supporters. This corrupt move eliminated any who saw the true nature of his actions, allowing him to continue unchallenged. If questioned, Kim ordered the execution and the execution of that individual and his entire family. Absolute corruption permeates through every action taken by Kim since becoming supreme leader, highlighting the underlying trend in humanity exposed by Lord Acton. The tendency of power is to corrupt. This is seen in countless individuals throughout history, which we have clearly detailed, and it merits no further discussion. If power and corruption occur on a sliding scale, then it logically follows that absolute power would result in absolute corruption. The limitation of absoluteness to a human capacity is the only rational option. The only being capable of even grasping theoretical absoluteness in any form, let alone absolute power and absolute corruption, is God himself. To place true theoretical absoluteness into this conversation does a disservice to God, who is truly absolute, and to Acton, the man who would never have attempted to describe a human on the same plane. So let us pay homage to both these figures by remembering the truth in this debate, that power tends to corrupt, and absolute power corrupts absolutely. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for coming. First of all, I would like to address the first rule of statistics, which is that correlation does not necessarily equal causation. The pro team wishes to oversimplify the definition of power, confining it to manipulation. Further, for each example given of corrupt uses of power, we can counter with examples of benevolent uses of power. Of course, there are people in power who use their power corruptly. This is obvious, but this is not what the resolution is about. We are rather suggesting that power is not the cause for corruption, though it may reveal it. Now, I want to draw your attention to the pro team's flawed treatment of the second clause. They want to redefine it as much as possible because they know they cannot prove it to be true. What is absolute power? No being in the universe in all of history can be said to have absolute power besides God. It is therefore an unfathomable concept to debate, since God is the only one with absolute power and is also entirely incorruptible. Any other definition of absolute power must be relative in some sense, and how can something be relatively absolute? But even if one were to create some convoluted notion of finite humans being capable of absolute power, would they be absolutely corrupt? That is to say, irredeemable? Power can be used for empowerment to bring hope to the hopeless. If absolute power is attainable by any human being, then God's redemptive power is not so glorious. If absolute corruption is possible in any sense, then the image of God made evident in humanity is no longer permanent. The pro team knows that the second clause of the resolution is especially theologically problematic, so do not let them fool you with an incomplete explanation for something which simply cannot in any context be tested or proven true. Thank you.
You've probably heard this expression before. Power tends to corrupt, and absolute power corrupts absolutely. Perhaps upon entering this debate, you are already inclined to believe this resolution to be true. This concept, as with many cliches, is attractive at first. Power tends to corrupt. An apple a day keeps the doctor away. Time heals all wounds. Practice makes perfect. I'm afraid that this resolution is an example of conventional wisdom that we often don't think about critically. And this isn't our fault. We often hear power associated with historically significant individuals, such as Hitler, Stalin, and Mao. These bad examples of power may stand out, but isn't the mother of a child exercising power? Think about everyday examples of power. The power of a professor, of a student, or a local government official, or of a pastor. Although we limit our conception of power to bad examples, power is more than an attribute of bad leaders. It's an idea we exercise daily. So, how can we consider this complex resolution where power is an idea and not simply a character trait? Let's refer to the word's Latin roots. The Latin word for power is potere, and potere simply means to be able. That's it, to be able. Notice that there are no negative or positive notions to this term. It may help you to think about this definition in terms of means and ends. Power simply gives you the means to accomplish particular ends. These ends may be moral, or these ends may be corrupt. Power is only the tool, it's not the weapon. We must recognize the neutrality of power in order to understand our social world. Bertrand Russell said, "The fundamental concept in social science is power, in the sense in which energy is the fundamental concept in physics." So why am I bringing this to your attention? Why must we remember that power means to be able? Because the pro team throughout the course of this debate will narrow power's definition. They want you to believe that power is bad, that it is dominant and coercive, that power is a zero-sum game in which there is only one winner. To persuade you of this negative concept of power, the pro team will focus on political expressions of power. They will speak of power not as neutral, but in secondary senses, where power is already conjoined to the evil of our hands. In this manner, the pro team is defining power in terms that already limit power to its negative capacities. But this depiction of power is simplistic and naive. Power is not simply dominion. If we concede to power as dominion, we are conceding to a notion of power that does away with any form of social justice and empowerment. Civil disobedience is power. Martin Luther King's march on Washington was an act of power. Social justice requires a positive concept of power. This brings us to power's potential to corrupt. In recognizing that power is a neutral idea, we are doing away with any presuppositions that automatically assume that power is the agent that corrupts. We are arguing that humans are not corrupted by power, but rather, being self-interested, imperfect creatures, we often use power in ways that reflect our corrupt self-interest. Let's consider the second part of this resolution, which states that absolute power corrupts absolutely. The pro team may avoid this clause because it cannot possibly be proven true. But let me quickly remind you of the burden of proof that lies on the pro team. To prove this debate's resolution, the pro team must show that power tends to corrupt and absolute power corrupts absolutely. If the pro team fails to prove either part of this conjunction, then they have failed to prove the resolution entirely. It is your responsibility to hold the pro team accountable to prove the full resolution. So, absolute power corrupts absolutely. Here in the second clause, there is no tens. So don't let the pro team convince you that they are supporting a modest claim. The opposing team wants to avoid this clause because no being, apart from an incorruptible God, can attain absolute power. So they assert absolutely, not as a tendency, the part of the resolution for which no human example could exist. Perhaps even more indefensible than the claim that humans can attain absolute power is the claim that any human can be absolutely corrupt. If we assert that all humans, even the most depraved, are made in the image of God, how can we say that one can be corrupted absolutely? Can God's good design in human mankind ever be so warped that it is absolutely destroyed? We assert that it cannot, and that some good, redeemable structure remains in all of God's created things. Which brings us to our conclusion. It's not that power corrupts, but that corrupt, self-interested humans wield power for their own corrupt ends. If we concede to the notion that power tends to corrupt, then we concede to a negative concept of power. We concede to power as masculine, as hegemonic, as a zero-sum game. We concede to the individuals who have used power corruptly, and we make them our standard. We need to remember the acts of power that redeem. We need to remember that for every Nero, there is a Mandela. For every Bin Laden, there is a Lincoln. And for every sinner, there is one Christ who showed us the greatest act of power on the cross. Thank you.
Good evening. First of all, the opposition is using a definition of power just out of a dictionary, while our definition is formed from history, from psychology, and from a lived reality. The opposition would like you to believe that a person who is morally depraved, The opposition in their first rebuttal stated that power does not cause corruption, but simply reveals it. We would like to say that the veracity of this resolution does not in any way depend on pre-existing moral tendencies. This has been proven through many psychological studies linking power to corruption. Those involved in the Stanford prison experiment were not selected because of a moral tendency to deprivation. They were selected randomly, and some abused their power because of the position of power that they were given. Furthermore, through this example, we can see clearly that power tends to corrupt. You might be thinking, give me an example of someone morally good who abused their power once they had it. Here's one. Dozens of revolutionaries who successfully overthrew brutal dictatorships ended up just as corrupt as those they overthrew. Liberia, Uganda, Ethiopia are a few that come to mind. These revolutionaries went into a position of higher power with a good moral compass, motivated by human rights or devotion to democracy or capitalism. It was the power that led them to negative actions rather than a predetermined moral compass. And looking at the second part of the resolution, to reinforce our opening statement, we'd like to stress the importance of understanding that true absolutes are in no way attainable by human beings. Just as we use a well-known symbol to help us imagine the nature of infinity, the term absolute is simply a word in our vocabulary used in an attempt to grasp a theoretical concept. Absolute power, as we are dealing with it, is power much less encumbered and of a far greater scope. This power exists and it corrupts even to our moral absolute.
We, the affirmative case, would like to stress that power does indeed tend to corrupt, and that absolute power does corrupt absolutely. Now, just to reiterate a few points, we would like to put forth that power should be treated as the capacity to influence, manipulate, or control a group or person's possessions, means, beliefs, ideas, and actions. Now, I know that this is a wordy definition, but it's one that we really think is necessary to use in the treatment of the resolution. We are treating power as Lord Acton treated power, conventionally, Power in the sense of position of influence. Power over, not power to or with. Corruption, similarly, should not be treated in the colloquial sense. When we say corruption, we are not referring to moral depravity, though the corrupt use of power could certainly lead to moral depravity. Corruption, in this context, is the abuse of power with the intent of personal gain. I encourage you to take note, corruption is contingent on power. One cannot be both corrupt and powerless. Certainly, one can be powerless and morally depraved, but again, we are not equating the two. Corruption, put simply, is abuse of power. In using these definitions, though, we find it necessary to specify a few things that we are not purporting about the nature of power. For one, in saying that power tends to corrupt, we are not saying that individuals should avoid holding power, or that holding power is in itself immoral. This would really be an entirely different debate. But I recognize the good Christian might reasonably ask, should I hold power if it will probably corrupt me? Well, yes, because saying that power tends to corrupt is not a damning statement. It is description more than prescription. It is humbly recognizing our propensity to sinfulness, especially in situations of power and influence. You, in a position of power, could wield that in a right way. You could seek justice and peace rather than personal gain. This is a lived reality and something that we've witnessed in leaders like Mahatma Gandhi, Nelson Mandela, Mother Teresa, Martin Luther King Jr., the list goes on and on. Further, in saying that power tends to corrupt, we are not saying that power always corrupts. Power tends to corrupt to the extent that being in a position of power gives individuals more of a platform to abuse that power at the cost of others. The more power, the more likely that person is to abuse that power and thus be corrupt. Wielding power is like playing with fire. Control it or get burnt. And I mean, is this even really debatable? You can clearly see that those in positions of power are more prone to corruption than their less powerful counterparts. Who can compare, after all, the Stalins of the world to the elementary school teachers, the popes to the undocumented immigrants, and the Maos to the marginalized? While every person fundamentally retains their humanity and all are created in the image of God, it is nevertheless the case that your effect on the world at large is dictated by the amount of power that you have. Your first grade teacher, while definitely important, does not have the same breadth of influence as, say, Stalin. Thus, Stalin is more likely to be corrupt. In this specific case, Stalin was more corrupt with, get this, an estimated 34 to 49 million unnatural deaths linked to his tyrannical hold over the USSR. Further, in discussing absolute power, we find it critically necessary to specify that Acton was not speaking as philosopher, theologian, or metaphysical theorist. Acton was talking about a lived political situation, and his version of absolute was real and manifested in the leaders of the time. So in saying that absolute power corrupts absolutely, we are not talking metaphysically. Indeed, true absolutes are not even entities that can be dealt with in a human context. Therefore, within the human context, absolute power is the greatest degree of power that can be reached by a person or persons. And this is, as Lord Acton intended it, a bit arbitrary. Regardless, corruption is contingent on power, so to have power is to tend towards the abuse of it. And let's remember, it was the powers and principalities that crucified our Christ Jesus on that cross. These were not horrible, morally depraved people seeking the downfall of the Savior. Rather, they were regular people like you and me, corrupted by their seat of influence, recognizing in Jesus an opportunity to appease the masses, benefiting their own immediate lives and careers at the cost of the Christ. I ask you, does this not clearly demonstrate the tendency of power to corrupt? Thank you.
You said there's a positive correlation between the first and second clauses, and that's how you're going to prove the second clause. But mathematically, that's actually incoherent. To prove an infinite, as is the second clause, you must have a lower level function to build from. In your case, this is the first clause. But if you were to build the proof of an infinite off of, say, 2 + 2 = 4, then 2 + 2 would have to always equal 4. But the first clause reads tens. The opposing team cannot make the claim that they just did because the first clause says tens, not absolutely tense. You're trying to prove an infinite off of a tendency. The opposing team has sought to create a definition of power that's twisted to fit their own argument. In your definition, absolute power has become relative, but there's no such thing as relatively absolute. Someone cannot make an absolute claim and then say it's only relatively true. That it's only true if we exclude certain examples like God, and if we cap it upon our human experience. But how do you define power? And is power more than the narrow definition the opposing team has given us? Power can be still, it can be quiet, just as it can be bold and outright. Love is an act of power. To be meek is to be powerful, and it feels like the opposing team has forgotten this. To hold political office is to hold power. That's why my team has taken a broad understanding of power. Remember, it's a neutral vehicle to be used or misused. Power has never corrupted us. We have only corrupted power. Thank you.
As we have previously mentioned, unless the definition of absolute power is so watered down that it becomes relatively absolute, God is the only being who can accurately be called absolutely powerful. For the sake of proving the resolution, the pro team excludes this sole example, revealing that the corrupt use of power is subject dependent. When a benevolent subject, such as God, wields power, its use is benevolent. When already fallen humans wield it, its use is naturally fallen and self-interested. This is why we echo William Gaddis in saying, power doesn't corrupt, people corrupt power. Perhaps the flaws in this resolution will be made clearer if we think of it as an experiment. The pro team wants to determine whether power causes corruption. Therefore, power is the independent variable, and corruption the dependent. Unfortunately, the entire sample of subjects, humans, which they enlist to defend their idea, is already contaminated by an underlying variable, sin. Once they apply power and see the corrupt ends for which it is used, they posit that power corrupted, when in fact, the corruption was there from the start. This would be a hack experiment. Yet that is what the pro team is doing, falsely attributing the corruption of already corrupt beings to increased power. Corruption is perversion, when something turns away from its intended right purpose. In the context of power, corruption twists these greater means into a tool to serve self-interest. But this describes abuse of power, a corruption of power. This implies that it is humanity that distorts power, not vice versa. Therefore, any leader's pattern of misuse cannot be used to demonstrate that pattern corrupts that official, but rather that sinful people corrupt power. Now again, we in no way deny that power is often utilized for atrocious purposes. But simply showing the misuses of power, however, doesn't address this resolution, which asserts that power itself corrupts its user. In order to prove that power is warping its wielder, you must prove that one's inner integrity is moved from a purer to diluted state. But is it truly integrity if it disappears as soon as means to evil present themselves? Certainly not. The resolution then uses power as a scapegoat for the effects of the fall, claiming that power, rather than sin, brings about corruption. The pro team would probably agree that corruption is present, but would then argue that power increases corruption. This is a misconception. Of course, the greatest evils are committed by those with the greatest power. This isn't because dictators are benevolent, sweet guys until that pesky power makes them self-interested. It is rather because selfish interest carries through from positions of least power to positions of greatest power. The actions influenced by this consistent self-interest simply become more observable and devastating as power increases. As a recent study published in the Journal of Applied Psychology demonstrated, people's sense of moral identity, the degree to which they thought it was important to their sense of self to be caring, compassionate, fair, generous, and so on, shaped their responses to feelings of power. Power doesn't change ethical tendencies, but pre-existing integrity determines power's use. Think of it as a percentage. If a person acts on 50% of their opportunities to do evil, as the opportunities increase, so will the occurrences. For example,
A person with little power who experiences 10 opportunities to do evil will act on 5 of them. However, a person with superior power, say 100 opportunities, will act on 50 of them. This dramatic increase in the number and gravity of evil deeds makes the powerful one appear more corrupt, when in fact the powerless one simply has an equal means to evil as someone of greater power. Other studies have further shown that pre-existing ethical tendencies are not altered but simply revealed through power. As one study put it, power isn't corrupting, it's freeing. What power does is it liberates the true self to emerge. Once you get into a position of power, then you can be whoever you are. Similarly, a study that tracked ethical tendencies among Zambian political officials found that positions of power actually made their holders less self-interested and more altruistic. In conclusion, power is a neutral force that cannot actively corrupt. It's simply a magnifying glass which amplifies and accurately displays someone's true integrity. Don't fall for the scapegoat. Instead, recognize that power does not corrupt, but simply reveals pre-existing ethical tendencies. As Bob Marley once said, if something can corrupt you, you're corrupt already. Thank you.
Our opponents tonight have bandied around some very interesting definitions. First of all, I would like to say that the reason we have decided to confine absolute power to what we have confined it to is not arbitrary. We are basing it off of the context of what Acton actually said. To take our debate outside of that context entirely is to do a disservice both to Acton and to this debate. Power, first of all, is not an ability. If we look back at the context of what Acton said, while this is an alternate definition of the word power as an ability that they have been considering, it really isn't the same thing and has no place in this discussion. When speaking of kings, popes, and other leaders that Acton was also speaking of, the definition does not make sense. We are not speaking of personal abilities, but of certain offices and positions that certain figures hold. And these necessarily involve power over, not power to. This is why power can corrupt anyone, because anyone can hold an office, while not everyone can have certain abilities. In addition, to deal with power as a neutral force, in a way, power is neutral, because it is not evil. God has power over his creation, and so power is not inherently evil, just as the animals, plants, and matter in our world are not in themselves evil. But to say that it is not power that corrupts because power is neutral would be a misunderstanding. When you spill water onto your computer, you don't call water evil, but you also don't say that it wasn't the reason your computer no longer works. Humans are sinful. Pour from the glass of water too generously, power too generously, and the results won't be pretty. In a democratic society where the bulk of power is usually not held by one person, it is easy to forget the dangers inherent in dictatorships. Alexis de Tocqueville, a French historian acquainted with the abuses of the French Revolution, warns Americans against forgetting this. He says in his book, Democracy in America, only God can be omnipotent without danger, because his wisdom and justice are always equal to his power. There is, therefore, no earthly authority so worthy of respect or vested with so sacred a right that I would wish to allow it unlimited action and unrestricted dominance. Thank you.
Yes. Question to the con team. The pro team defined corruption as the misuse of power. However, I don't recall hearing what you defined corruption as.
Thank you. Yeah, as Naomi pointed out, corruption we think is more has to do with your deep moral integrity rather than just how you use a position of power. Let me just say one more thing on definitions. I noticed that The pro team was attacking a lot of our definitions as simplistic. Our definition of power is ability to accomplish ends. So obviously a king or a pope would have a greater ability to accomplish ends. Their definitions, on the other hand, to prove that power corrupts, are define power as manipulation, which is the first word they used to define it, and then define corruption as something that can only happen when you have power. I think that's sort of a twisting of those definitions to fit the resolution.
Thank you.
Andrew, this question is directed towards the con side again. I wanted to know what you guys think of the concept of killing someone. Do you think that's an act of absolute power or just relative power?
Version of either definition. Be able to call that absolute power. Hey, there we go. Yeah, I don't think you'd be able to call that absolute power. But I would point out with that example, people who are very powerful kill, people who don't have much power at all kill. So I think that sort of shows the point that we're trying to demonstrate, that people can commit corrupt actions at a low level or a high level. It's just much more highlighted when it's Hitler, Stalin, Mao, those examples that come to mind, because this massive amount of power, obviously, when someone uses that corruptly, it's clearer than when I, as a Gordon College student, sort of act on my self-interest. Yeah.
I just would like to say one thing in response, because I feel like we have a right to respond to that as well. And I think it's very interesting that the con team accuses us of limiting the definition of power. However, they would say that power is so broadly just the ability to. So I wonder how, even based on that definition, they could say one person has any more power to and then another, if everybody has the ability to do anything. The thing that changes a person's ability and increases their ability to do anything is the position of power afforded to them.
Very quick response, how someone can have more power than someone else. Our definition was ability to accomplish ends. Someone with greater means to accomplish a greater amount of ends has more power than another. So that would apply to someone like a king or a political official. Despot is someone with much greater power. We're not saying that I have equal power with Kim Jong-un. I think he can accomplish a lot more ends than I can, unfortunately.
Thanks, my name's Davis. I have a question for the pro team. So most people in this room have heard this phrase before. Almost no one in this room, I assume, has heard of Lord Atten. Why then do you insist on contextualizing this resolution?
Because first of all, in order to understand at all what he was saying, is we have to put it in the context of who he's actually addressing and why he was addressing them. He was speaking to a historian who decided he didn't want to talk about all the bad things that the popes and the kings had done. And so he was deciding to say, hey, you can't do that. You have to expose what these people have said and done. And that's why we've defined corruption as the abuse of power, because that was what he was afraid of, is people not looking at what these people have done corruptly. And that's also why I've decided to define absolute power within a human context, because Acton was afraid of a real thing. And if we choose to ignore that, then we're sort of ignoring the point of what he was saying. Thank you.
I would also like to add that of any group of people, perhaps Christians and religious people should be more aware about taking a specific saying out of context. So context is probably important to us.
Hi, I'm Elizabeth, and I hate public speaking, so I'm going to pick on Nathan, because you're the one I know, sort of. You used the analogy of the water corrupting the computer. Doesn't that analogy actually support the con side, because the water would be corrupting the person who spilled it, and we can't say that the water could corrupt this or could cause the person who spilled it to be a klutz. They're already klutzy. They're already corrupt. And the water was just the means to an end. So wouldn't that analogy be better used by that side?
Well, since corruption is just the abuse of power, giving someone that power, in other words, giving them that water to spill, is the problem. So once you give them that tool, then it's easy for them to abuse it.
Hi, I'm Natalie. So for the pro team, in the analogy of the spilling water on your computer, it is the person who, how do I word this? It is the person who spills water on the computer who is to blame for the use of that water in that way. And it is not, you know, the water's fault in that analogy. So in this, in this analogy applied to this statement, where the statement is structured as power tends to corrupt. So power is the subject of this sentence, and it is doing the corrupting. How do you, I guess, reconcile that the power is doing the corrupting to the power being the tool which is used to corrupt?
Yeah, thank you for the question. I think that people are perhaps reading into this analogy a little too much. I mean, let's picture a glass of water next to a computer. A gust of wind comes and knocks over the glass, and it breaks the computer. And that, like, we're not trying to put a person in this situation. So it's, what we're saying is that it's the water that breaks the computer in the same way that it's power that corrupts. It's not, like, you can't separate it. You can't say that the water is evil. In the same way, we're not saying that the person is evil, we're just saying that the water breaks and that the power corrupts. Thank you.
A non-water analogy.
Yeah. Hi, my name is Lily. I have a question about the, like, the, essentially the cause of corruption. I think if power is not corrupting, I would, I think, well, I'm kind of addressing both sides. I partly, okay, I'll address the negative case. If power is not the, if power does not corrupt absolutely, then I would like to know what y'all think the root of corruption is. If it's not power, if power is not necessarily a, an essential component to that.
I think broadly, we would say that the fall corrupts all of creation, and so it corrupts everything we can do with our hands. So anything humans touch may be used in a way that makes that thing look like it corrupts us, but I would argue that really what we see in this case is we're using the tool of power and misusing it based on our self-interest. So I would say the fall, I would say sin, I would say the way that's manifested in context of this resolution is self-interest, and in the context of power, I would say it's pursuing self-interest at the expense of public good.
I also want to say something
me.
In response to that.
Yeah, so, like, along with what Sam was saying, you know, you can say that, like, anything can be used in a corrupt way, so, like, food can be used in a corrupt way, it's called gluttony. Sex can be used in a corrupt way, it's called lust. And we're saying that that power is much like those neutral things of food and sex or money or humor or, all of these neutral powers.
I just want to talk about, like, what we think about corruption for a second. When we think of corruption, think of, like, a police officer who's accepting a bribe. When he's given that bribe, no one's giving it to him because they want him to do something. They want him to use his position, his power, in order to do something. That's what corruption is. That's the best way we can understand that, is why would, no one is going to give him that bribe if they can't do something for him with his position.
Hi, my name is Gary, and Naomi's grandfather. But, I guess well, I think I'm going to address the other side because my wonder is that we're only talking about adults and people that we've allowed to take power, we've given them power. What about if children, or, and I say the negative side, a baby has power, it cries, it's fed, it's taken care of. So if power is totally corruption, then how do we address the rest of the population in all ages?
Well, first of all, we're not saying that power always corrupts. We're just saying that power tends to corrupt. So in the case of a baby, like, most of those wouldn't be corrupt. And also, they also don't hold a significant amount of power. So if we consider power, like we've said, on a broad scale, the more power, the more the tendency to corrupt. Babies really don't have much power, so there's really not much chance of corruption there. So that's the most I can say for that.
Quick response, I would just say that the second clause has no tendency. So I think to act like this is a modest claim, but to also say there's a positive correlation from this tendency to then, but absolute power, that corrupts absolutely. I think that correlation isn't founded.
I would just like to say one thing. I think it's really interesting that the Khan team continues to set up this relationship and they keep kind of compressing it into a mathematical equation. When we started to do research for this debate, we looked across pretty much all of the major disciplines. And most, if you look at economics, business, psychology, sociology, most disciplines agree with the resolution that power tends to corrupt and absolute power corrupts absolutely. Psychology experiments, starting with the Stanford Prison Experiment and continuing until today, have proven that this is true. A recent psychologist just last year did an experiment where they were able to show that people who had increased positions of power showed similar temporal activity as a sociopath. So achieving a position of power caused their brain to decrease empathetic responses to people. So. We're not just pulling this out of thin air. We are looking at a deep and rich historical tradition, and that is why we feel that this resolution is true.
Hi, my name is Jeffrey. I have a question similar to what the gentleman behind me said, but I'm going to direct it towards the affirmative side. You mentioned a lot in your examples that you gave for the people in position of absolute power, like Hitler, Stalin, Kim Jong-un, and you said that it led to like thousands of deaths and all that. Is it possible to be for absolute power to corrupt and not lead to death, or is death an inevitable consequence of absolute power?
Yeah, thank you for that question. I think we're not saying that death necessarily is equated to an abuse of power. I think, unfortunately, when we think about the rulers and those individuals throughout history that have held the closest human approximation of absolute, I think it's also, just as a side note, interesting that the pro team is trying to advocate for a concept that they can't even fully understand. We can't really understand what absolute is for God, so why are we trying to talk about it now? If we think about the rulers that have been able to abuse their power, oftentimes it looks like death, but it can look like any number of things. We can think about money laundering, we can think about oil rent states where the rulers drive fleets of Mercedes and the people are starving. I mean, there's like just an innumerable number of examples where we see the peak of human power leads to an abuse of power. It can be any number of things, but it would lead to an abuse of power.
can I reply to that?
Oh, I have one more thing. Also, if the con team is saying that the root is moral depravity or sin, I think we would say that kind of makes sense, because if you're saying that power is, if we are saying power tends to corrupt, it makes sense. We're not going to try and argue that sin does not pervade every aspect of society, but power is what gives somebody the ability to abuse that. Thank you.
We think power does give people the ability to abuse it, but it doesn't increase their depravity. It's exactly what you said, but that's not what the resolution is. The resolution is that power corrupts, not that just that we use power corruptly. That's
I never said
argument.
It increased depravity. I just said they could abuse their power.
But that's what corruption is.
Hi, my name's Andrew. Yep.
Thank you. My name is Annika, and I just have a question for the negative side regarding absolute power, because throughout history, we've discussed politically absolute powers, especially, and growing up, even in elementary and middle school, I've heard about absolute power and been given definitions of what that means with respect to people in politics being able to do whatever they want to do because of their power, people like Kim Jong-un. So certainly absolute power with respect to God, we can't talk about corrupting, but how would you respond to this other definition of absolute power that we've been discussing for years?
Yeah, again, in that sense, we would argue that someone's self-interested nature continues on to absolute power. So it appears as if they're much more corrupt than you and I. I know my heart. I know I'm corrupt as well, even though I don't have a lot of power. But basically what we're saying is absolute power, it seems like they're more corrupt because they have greater means to evil ends. One thing that the pro team mentioned, first, just the argument that every discipline agrees on this point that was made earlier, that just isn't the case. We cited psychological studies, they cited psychological studies. The problem with some of the psychological studies that they've shown are they only measure the results, they only measure the use of power. They don't measure is power actually doing the corruption. Stanford Prison Experiment, for example, I think actually can be used to support our side, because what it shows is people not in positions of power very long, as soon as they're given power, already shows that they have the willingness to misuse it. It doesn't show that power corrupted. It shows that humans generally already have a self-interested nature in them that is heightened, and you can see it much clearer when they have a lot of power. Yeah, Jeffrey.
I've to respond to you again, Annika, often the way that we use the term absolute, especially when we talk about it in human terms, is akin to how we use the word literally. Right, so, but in a debate like this, we actually are taking the debate, taking the resolution very seriously, and so when we actually think about absolute power, it's very clear that the only being with absolute power is the omniscient God. So although in certain contexts in your classroom in high school, you might use the term absolute akin to how you use literally, that doesn't mean in human terms people actually have absolute power.
Yeah, thank you. I'd like to respond too. I think that their argument is actually contingent on the relativization of corruption. I mean, it seems like Sam especially is suggesting that he is perhaps as corrupt as Hitler, and I don't think that many of us in this room would really argue that. But this actually leads into my first question. I would like to ask, like, given the dangers, especially we as Christians, as India commented, given the dangers of quoting and arguing things out of context, why are you insisting on taking this out of the context of Acton and arguing it in the philosophical realms? Thank you.
Yeah, thank you for asking that, actually, because that's the next thing we kind of wanted to address. We're not arguing what did Lord Acton think. I agree that Lord Acton thought what you guys think. I also think Lord Acton was wrong. We're arguing about this resolution. We're not arguing, this isn't a historical argument. This is a normative statement that's been pulled out of Acton's letter. And we're saying, no, this cliche that's emerged out of Acton's letter shouldn't be applied universally as a normative statement. We're not arguing that about what Acton said. And we recognize that you agree with Acton, but our team, we don't agree with Acton. We don't think this should be a rule.
I mean, maybe you are pulling it out of his statement, but if that's so, I think you're fundamentally misunderstanding what he meant when he said the statement. When he was saying that absolute power corrupts absolutely, he was talking about a real situation, and his version of absolute was arbitrary. To argue it as though we're talking about God instead of popes and kings is false and dishonest to the resolution. Thank you.
I do agree that it is a bit arbitrary. It's our question, yeah.
Sorry.
I guess what I would ask is if you've defined power in a way, now that we've sort of taken this as a normative statement, if you've defined power as manipulation, power over, then which of these acts better fits your definition of power? Christ's death on the cross or Hitler's reign?
I'm admittedly struggling to understand the point of your question. Can you rearticulate it?
The point of the question is that I think the model of power, I won't answer the question what we think about it. The idea of the question is you've limited your definition of power to already its negative capacities of manipulation by your own definition of power. Which one?
We said power is the capacity to and the capacity over, not a manipulation.
The first definition you gave that Marissa gave was manipulation.
Sometimes people use illustrative examples to prove a point.
Also, manipulation and influence. Manipulation is one instance.
I'd still like to hear the answer to that question, though. So, I'm gonna read it again. Which of these acts better fits your definition of power? Christ's death on the cross or Hitler's reign?
Yeah, thank you, Jeffrey, for rereading the question. I think that we are limiting power to the human sense. So Christ's death on the cross, Christ is both fully God and fully human. So I think to the extent that the powers and principalities nailed Christ to the cross is indeed a big exertion of power and displays the fact that power does indeed tend to corrupt, that they would literally crucify the Christ. Thank you.
Why do we have to pick one? They're both instances of it. Just because Jesus was absolutely perfect, even as a human being, which means the results of the use of that power are not going to be the same as the results of the use of Hitler's power. Both are great instances of power. It's just the fact that one person was sinless, one person wasn't.
Do you mean he was absolutely perfect or absolutely perfect?
All right. So we've picked a definition of corruption that's actually measurable. How do you measure someone's internal corruption and actually say that power does or does not even increase their corruption?
I think that's something that's fundamentally difficult. I'd say we're not trying to necessarily measure it, although psychological studies we've cited have tried to come up with ways to measure it. I actually think the problem with the pro argument is that they've tried to measure it by just looking at, like, okay, what are the results of this person's power, instead of, is power moving this person from a place where they're less self-interested to more self-interested?
I think we've given some examples to show that that is the case. We cited numerous examples of revolutionaries who were supposedly motivated by moralistic tendencies and standards and overthrew vicious dictators that had been exerting horrible consequences on their society. So they were motivated by a desire to make their world a better place. Once they were in a position of power, they abused that power. And we talked about President Mugabe, who has been, I think anyone, it would be difficult for anyone to say that he is behaving in a way that he promised he would when he began to take power. So I think we have given numerous examples of that.
Okay. India's statement actually supports our side. She used the word moralistic tendency, which is something that inevitably cannot be actually measured. What we are saying is that once people rise to power, then that is when you see the fruit of whether or not they are oriented towards incorruption or corruption. What India has said is when a lot of people rise to power, you see their bad fruit of corruption. Again, we're
he
saying...
He was good before he took power, and then he took power.
Right,
and then
so how are you measuring... How are you exactly are you measuring that he was good before he took power? Do you just decide that?
No. Based off of the standards that you have put forth, whether or not somebody is good or bad, you say people... It reveals pre-existing moralistic tendencies. If his pre-existing moralistic tendency was to abuse his power, was to murder people, was to abuse a democratic system, was to rig elections, why wouldn't we have seen, if that's the fruit of the abuse of his power and his moralistic tendencies, why wouldn't we have seen some element of that abuse before he took power? He led in a positive way. He led a good group of people to overthrow a horrible dictator, and it wasn't until he was in a position of power that he began to abuse it.
Quick response to that. I mean, nobody comes to power admitting that they're going to kill people. I don't think that works very well. It's called campaigning. And we don't really know their, yeah.
I would just ask simply again, do people without a great amount of power, like you and me, are we corrupt? Or is it impossible, based on your definition, for us to be corrupt?
I think I'm pretty concerned about the conflation between power and agency or morality. I think that the Kahn team is attempting to conflate several issues in order to support their argument. What we are purporting is that people are people. I have sin, you have sin, we all have the potential for things to go wrong. However, power the possession of power is what corrupts, and the possession of power is what allows us to abuse power, not the other way around, and not in the way that you are describing.
Power. Absolute power. Let that sink in for a moment. What kinds of images come to mind? A tyrannical ruler? A business tycoon? The villain from your favorite story? Is there a single person in this room who imagines a positive scenario in which one human possesses absolute power over another? We are here tonight to discuss the veracity of Lord Acton's claim that power tends to corrupt, and absolute power corrupts absolutely. Given the evidence that we've put forth, it's easy to see that this statement is absolutely true. Acton's claim that power tends to corrupt is clearly seen in history, literature, and psychology, as we've shown through numerous examples, but it's also seen in business and economics. The Panama Papers offer a lengthy list of people today who abuse their power for personal gain. Enron took advantage of its organizational and financial power over shareholders, and Bernie Madoff scammed thousands of clients out of billions of dollars. No matter what discipline we look at, literature and history in the humanities, or economics and psychology in the sciences, we find countless examples that power tends to corrupt. With the first part of Acton's statement more than thoroughly proven, we can see how it naturally leads into the second clause, that absolute power corrupts absolutely. This resolution doesn't really even make sense unless we consider it in a human context. We should be thinking about absolute power as held by monarchs and popes, not some notion of theoretical power. And indeed, this is how the quote was originally intended, for Acton was speaking as a historian, not as a philosopher. No human can possess absolute power without any limitations. This is an impossible task, to say the least. Mankind's inevitable death creates the most obvious limitation. Knowing this, it becomes foolish to discuss absolute power as an abstract idea. The only reasonable and logical way to discuss absolute power is in a human context, one in which the concept of absolute power is actually achievable. This proper context is necessary to fully understand absolute power. An individual's power becomes absolute when there are no longer any credible competitors who could usurp it. At this point, an individual is able to completely exercise their power without any legitimate fear of losing it. Because mankind is finite, we cannot possess absolute power as is commonly associated with God. Mankind is not omnipotent. If the opposition wants to debate whether mankind can be all-powerful, they will hear no rebuttals from us. We would go even further. Mankind cannot be absolutely powerful, but neither can we be absolutely loving, nor absolutely knowledgeable, nor possess any other quality which belongs to God alone. In bringing the notion of absolute power into a human context, it's helpful to use another analogy. Just as power tends to corrupt, dehydration tends to cause migraines. Extending this metaphor further illuminates Acton's second claim. With more dehydration comes worsening migraines. Similarly, with more power comes worsening corruption. When the power possessed by an individual reaches its peak, its absolute maximum, corruption also reaches its peak. Corruption is the abuse of power for personal gain. It is completely dependent on power. Daylight is completely dependent on the sun. When the sun reaches its maximum point in the sky, that is the most light that will be given off throughout the day. Absolute sunshine illuminates absolutely. This may seem like a sad reality. God puts humans in positions of power, even though he knows it will lead to corruption. But this is not meant to be a damning statement at all. In fact, it allows us to understand our own limitations, and so take precautions against them. If we know the dangers of acquiring power, we can protect ourselves and others from those dangers and fight against it. We've been talking and answering questions for over an hour now, and you've heard thousands and thousands of words. Put simply, there's no debate that power tends to corrupt. And the fact that absolute power corrupts absolutely follows naturally. Of course we can't be as powerful as God, because we are not God. To vote for the opposition simply because they claim that power is some metaphysical force that is completely neutral would be irresponsible. We've chosen the most obvious, intuitive, and enduring definitions of power and corruption. To change these long-held definitions simply to counteract a longer-held belief is conniving. We have used definitions and examples to which everybody is accustomed. Using these, we have shown that the only logical conclusion of this debate is to say, with certainty, that power does indeed tend to corrupt, and absolute power does corrupt absolutely. Thank you.
Wow. First of all, I just really want to say thank you to everyone for coming, and especially thank you to the pro team. I mean, this has been so much fun. When we look at the world today, it's really easy to assume that power tends to corrupt. I mean, we hear all of these stories like the pro team has given to us, such as bygone dictators, current perpetrators of genocide. And then we jump to this conclusion that, you know, power is the cause of the corruption. I get it, guys. I really, really do. But I'm sorry to say that that's a scapegoat argument. It doesn't deal with the root of the problem, it just misdirects us. The goal of the pro team tonight has been to prove the scapegoat argument, that power corrupts, power hurts the world, power does this, power does that. I'm sorry to say though, power is not an actor, it doesn't do anything. Power is an idea whose only capabilities are the capabilities that we grant it. Humans and power structures are flawed and broken, of course. Therefore, power can, of course, be used for evil ends, but it can also be used for good ends. I know that this seems like a technicality, talking about power being an actor, power not being an actor, and I get that that must be really tedious for you guys. But it's crucial, because it's the difference between power being a tool granted to us by God, which can be used for good or for evil, and power being a weapon whose purpose is for harming others. Friends, the resolution has many implications that are kind of dangerous, especially on theories of empowerment. And when I think of this, I'm a little unnerved. Because the truth, again, the simple truth, is that the resolution proposed by the opposition is incapable of defending empowerment and therefore social justice. You see, social justice requires the neutrality of power rather than just tendency towards corruption. Because, and the assumption that the pro team has put forward is that in some way power is stacked against the downtrodden and towards corruption. And this suggests the inability to change social systems. Think about the implications of the resolution, if it's right. All social justice would have to go because empowerment would merely be a weapon for corrupting the world and turning those whom we are trying to help into corrupt individuals. And by emphasizing power's negative uses and forcing it into this negative definition of power, we're ignoring the truth that the highest expression of power is the power of the cross. The cross is absolute power expressed absolutely. All other expressions of power must be viewed in relation to the cross. This is why empowerment is good. This is why a Gandhi is more powerful than a Stalin. This is why, for the past 2,000 years, the church has taught that to be poor is to be blessed, and to be weak is to be made strong. The cross, and not the concentration camp, is the standard by which we judge power. The resolution tonight, it's like a tower of cards. It consists of many interlacing, flimsy parts. And if one of these segments is not perfect, then the whole tower crumbles. It is your job as the audience to decide if every single one of these cards is stable. So, ask yourselves, do you believe that power itself corrupts? Or do you corrupt humans use the neutral tool of power? Are humans capable of absolute power? Can a human be absolutely corrupt? That is, can the image of God be corrupted? Can you accept the implications of this inherently negative view of power on social justice? The resolution requires that the points of tendency, absolute power, and absolute corruption be true. If you cannot support the resolution on any of these points, on any single one of these points, then the tower falls. Needless to say, we, the con team, disagree with the pro team. Otherwise, you wouldn't be here. We believe that power has the equal capacity to be used for good or for evil, with no inclination toward either extreme. We believe that absolute power is found only in God, expressed in the act of Christ on the cross. We believe absolute corruption is impossible because of the image of God on humanity and the goodness of all creation at its beginning. In short, we believe that power does not tend to corrupt, and that absolute power does not corrupt absolutely. Thank you.
Again, you have an important role. You have power, and you can exercise this corruptly or honestly. And again, I would just reiterate, not based on your affinity for particular people, or not really even your opinion on the matter, but who you thought, as you listened to them, made the most compelling case for what they really put a lot of research into and argued for tonight. So think about it, and don't be swayed by your neighbors as well. And then I'm going to ask, if you raise your hand, we have several counters, and we'll start with the pro team. If you think the pro team makes the most compelling case tonight, raise your hand and keep your hand up high. The affirmative team, so you think this group right here made the most compelling case. Keep them up. Keep them up, you know it. Okay, and now if you think the negative case made the strongest argument tonight, hold your hand up high. Let's count so we have a good number here, so keep them up. All right, you can put them down now, and sure. Let's give them a big hand when they come back in. Sure, you can sit down. You can sit down now. Again, thank you all for coming, and thank you for both sides and the captains for both sides. They've, again, put a tremendous amount of work into this in terms of research, in terms of interviewing faculty, and whatnot. So it did skew a little bit this time, but the pro team received 67, and the con team received 240. So we're going to award it to the con team. Thank you. Thank you all for coming, and you can come congratulate them individually. Thank you. Oh, come on.